here at the War Memorial in Ottawa, I thought I might share a laugh with Lieutenant Colonel Salaberry on the 200th anniversary of the burning of the White House in the same war of 1812, where he saved Lower Canada by repelling a much superior American force in 1813. Of course, not everybody thinks the burning of the White House is a laughing matter. When the British Embassy tweeted a picture of a cake with the White House, British and American flags, a couple of sparklers, and said, just sparklers this time, the internet erupted in fury, as it normally does. But nobody had minded much when the embassy earlier had announced a barbecue on the 200th anniversary of an unfortunate event. And in fact, it's remarkable. It's a tribute to the deep bonds among the English-speaking countries and also some far-sighted statesmanship that we can now look back and laugh at an incident that at the time didn't seem very funny. The president's wife, Dolly Madison, was forced to flee the White House clutching a valuable portrait of George Washington under her arm. But it was an interruption. Like, oddly enough, the American Revolutionary War. 7 years' fight ends in independence, the king is denounced as a tyrant, and then they signed the Treaty of Paris, which speaks of misunderstandings and differences which interrupted the good correspondence and friendship between them. And it turns out this wasn't just polite language. They meant it. In many ways, the American Revolutionary War was not between Americans and Britons, but between Whigs and Tories throughout the British Empire. And in fact, the Whigs came out on top in Britain as well as in the United States, though without the necessity of military fighting. Then you do get the War of 1812, partly because of Thomas Jefferson's exceptionally morally obtuse sympathy for revolutionary France. The Americans burn York, the British burn Washington. It could have gone very badly. As a matter of fact, toward the end of the war, the British, having defeated Napoleon, are in a position to bring over much superior forces and inflict a humiliating defeat on the Americans, but they decide this wouldn't be a good idea, taking the long view. As for the Americans, after the peace treaty is signed, but before word reaches the combatants, there was no internet in those days, Andrew Jackson whoops the British in the Battle of New Orleans. Doesn't just give the United States a war hero and future president, it also gives them control of the Mississippi and guarantees that they'll be a continental power. But they've had two rather ugly wars, both against the same British king. What's going to happen next? Well, I'll tell you. By 1818, they've agreed to demilitarize the Great Lakes, which is not something that really bitter enemies do. And then by 1823, when the Americans suddenly declare the entire Western Hemisphere off limits to European colonization, it's done with the tacit understanding and approval of the British, whose Royal Navy would have backed the Americans if France, Spain, or some other European power had tried to grab land in the New World. As Daniel Hannan says in Inventing Freedom, there really are these deep bonds among the Americans, the British, the Canadians, the Australians, the understanding of the individual liberty of parliamentary or congressional government, all representing restraint of the governors by the governed. I mean, there are other opportunities for it all to go very badly. The American Civil War, the British and the Americans almost came to blows over matters including differences about freedom of the seas. In fact, one American cabinet meeting got so heated that Lincoln had to chide his colleagues with, gentlemen, one war at a time. But by the late 19th century, all was peace and harmony, particularly behind the scenes. Indeed, the British went out of their way to lose a couple of diplomatic confrontations to the Americans to soften popular feeling, knowing they were going to need American help in a confrontation with Germany in the early 20th century over very different ideas of world order, of governance, of how the affairs of mankind ought to be ordered. So the British, the Americans, the Canadians are allies in the First World War, in the Second World War, in the Cold War. They are so united that, as a matter of fact, you can now look back in a way that Russians and Ukrainians can't do with their past. Now we can look back and laugh off the burning of the White House as a misunderstanding.